I'm Debanjan, Debanjan Ghosh. I'm a PhD candidate at Rutgers. I do computational linguistics. So basically, I try to infer meaning from text and how we can compose meaning from words and discourse and sentences, etc.
And I'm Vanessa Kitzie. I'm also a PhD student at the Rutgers School of Communication and Information. And I wanted to actually give you guys a little bit of information on my background because it contextualizes the motivations for doing this research. So in general, what I'm really interested in looking in is how individuals access information, and particularly taking that from a social angle, and looking at that in terms of inequities in access to information. Now, from a library and information science perspective, we often look at this problem in terms of information seeking. So in other words, we say there's someone who's trying to get this information, they really can't get it, what are the barriers and how can we kind of take these barriers down? But what I'm trying to do in my research is to identify other information practices that might be inhibiting these people from accessing information, different groups of people. And so kind of some of the practices that I'm looking at are around information use and also information awareness. So in other words, if you're aware of certain bits of information floating around, it's going to shape your kind of horizon of what you think it's possible for you to find and what you think is possible to be out there. And so what I'm interested in kind of looking at in terms of people using social media is what information is having the dominant voice and kind of how does that construction of having a dominant voice kind of happen. And so when doing this research, after the Eric Garner verdict on December 3rd, a lot of people took to Twitter kind of to express their outrage over the verdict. And this was something that I was monitoring at the time just because I found it very interesting. And over December 3rd and December 4th, two hashtags emerged that I became very interested in. One was called Criming While White. And so what this hashtag kind of was trying to do was to get white individuals to kind of detail accounts in which they had done something that was illegal in some sort of way and their experience with the criminal justice system and or police officers after they had committed this illegal act. And often this was ostensibly to kind of say, if I were of a different race, I would not have gotten off so lightly. This hashtag was actually started by a comedian who was a writer for the Jimmy Fallon show. And so also you can see that kind of the tweets that he put out were kind of meant to be almost comedic in a way, almost to laugh at it and say, isn't this ridiculous? So after a day, you also had Alive While Black, which was started by an Ebony.com senior digital editor. And so what she was trying to say is that you saw all these white voices coming out and kind of sharing their stories, but what they were doing by just sharing their experiences of privilege was not giving any sort of lip service or attention to stories from people of color. And so what she was saying here was she was asking black users to come on and to identify experiences that they've had in their lives with the police in order to give some attention to that. What I was interested in here was the initial media coverage of the use of these hashtags. So what you saw were kind of like twofold messaging. You had some news outlets who kind of posed this as compare the two hashtags, juxtapose them to see the differences in how people were experiencing treatment within the criminal justice system and by the police based on their race. And then you also had columnists who were coming against Criming While White and saying that there were issues with that hashtag because it was bringing so much attention to white experience, which is already a privileged experience, while not necessarily bringing attention to experiences of black or other people of color who might have had different ones than they did. And so what I was really wondering, based on this media coverage, is were these hashtags really that different? Because you had all of these news outlets who were kind of picking different examples from these hashtags and showing them when they were writing about them, but they only had examples. And so I thought, why don't we collect the Twitter data from when these hashtags were trending and see if there were both structural and content qualities that differed between both hashtags. And so I'm going to talk about the structural part, and then I'm going to give it over to Debanjan to talk about the content-oriented part. So a sub-question that I actually had with the structural portion of this research was this. Criming While White was reported to trend both domestically and worldwide, and to the best of my knowledge, Alive While Black only trended domestically. So my question here was, why did that happen? Why did Criming While White trend more than Alive While Black? And so there's a lot of answers for this. It could be that Cromming While White was started first, so it just had more time to trend as a hashtag. Or perhaps the media coverage that occurred was such that it drove people's attention to the hashtag, and therefore they used it more. For example, what you can see here is Google search results for pages that mentioned Cromming While White versus pages that mentioned Alive While Black. And you could see the disparity in the number of search results, much more favoring Cromming While White. You can also see this with Google News search results. But what I wanted to do was actually interrogate this in terms of the Twitter trending algorithm. And so in other words, was there something about the Twitter trending algorithm that was allowing Cromming While White tweets to trend more than Alive While Black tweets? And so Twitter doesn't really reveal their actual algorithm. They just give you information about how it works on their FAQ page as well as their blogs. And so from reading this, I kind of discerned two main ways in which Twitter's trending algorithm works. The first is by determining content that's novel. So in other words, if you're sharing novel content, it's more likely to trend. If you're sharing content that's on the same subject across the course of a week, it's less likely to trend as time progresses. Now, it doesn't always work this way. I'm sure as most of you have noticed, if you're Twitter users, Justin Bieber tends to trend a lot, right? But that's one portion of it. So another portion of how Twitter determines its algorithm is actually based on velocity of the tweets. And so this is why Justin Bieber might trend multiple times as time progresses. And so in other words, if a lot of different people are talking about a subject in a short amount of time, that could potentially be a characteristic that would constitute a trending topic. So I wanted to take these ideas of novelty and then also of velocity and examine within the actual network of how people were sharing tweets using both hashtags, whether you could see any acute differences that might key into these two important elements of the trending algorithm. So describing the data that I collected. So with Twitter, you can use the API to collect data, but it's important to note that you're never getting a random sample of what you're collecting. Basically, unless you have academic access through an institution to Twitter data and they give you the entire fire hose, you're not going to have that. We did not have such access. So we just did a Twitter API search. And this was because I started searching for these hashtags after they were trending, and I wanted to collect them as they were originating and as they were trending. So we collected about 180,000 tweets, and you had about double the amount of tweets that were of the Cromming While White hashtag than you did of the Alive While Black hashtag. So right there you can see that just in terms of volume, Cromming While White was being used a lot more. We also collected 10% which used both hashtags in tandem, but because we wanted to make direct comparisons between the two hashtags, we didn't include those for our analysis. However, that's something that could be an implication for future work. So some of the descriptive statistics that really stood out to me, we looked at the types of tweets that were being shared. So you could see that in Cromming While White, individuals were more likely, there was a higher proportion of individuals who were retweeting within Cromming While White. So when we're talking about content kind of moving within a network and velocity, sharing content is going to potentially make content more likely to trend because you have different people who are spreading the content as opposed to the same person sharing the content over and over again. For Alive While Black, on the other hand, you had more individuals who were actually just tweeting out content. They weren't necessarily sharing it. We also included mentions and replies in this collection. However, those distributions were around the same for each. You could also see that in Cromming While White, there were more followers and friends. And so if we just think of this broadly, there could be potential for more exposure when individuals who are using the Cromming While White hashtag are actually tweeting, just because they have more people who are paying attention to their tweets. But the most striking thing to me was actually the difference in the amount of URLs shared. Okay, you have a lot more people in Cromming While White who are sharing URLs than you do in Alive While Black. So I was kind of curious to see what exactly the URLs were that they were actually sharing. So I took the top three for each. So for Alive While Black, this was the most shared URL. And this is actually a Vine video of a young black man who is being followed by the general manager in a convenience store who thinks that he is trying to steal something. And so he's just filming it. So as you can see, this is a highly personal account, right, of someone who's kind of discriminating against him. You also see in Alive While Black, people actually sharing kind of meta reporting about the hashtag trending. And so that's the BBC trending. And then also there's this interesting kind of people's library tidbit that was shared by a lot of individuals, which was kind of taking a lot of different instances of black individuals being subject to police brutality, but putting it in such a way that it's not just one anecdote, but rather it kind of conveys a larger message about structural racism. And on the topic of structural racism, this comic also was something that was shared a lot. And again, I'm gonna flip through these relatively quickly because we have a lot of content, but essentially this comic is kind of discussing a black individual and a white individual and the differences and inequities in their treatment. In Crying While White, again, because the hashtag was kind of ostensibly started as something that was a little bit comedic, you had people sharing this Dave Chappelle video, and he's a comedian. You also had a lot of these sorts of URLs, which were providing anecdotes of white individuals who were perceived to be getting away with something, right? So you see these, and then there's one more. So network analysis of the data. So the next thing that I actually did was I constructed what's called a weighted directed network. And so essentially what that means is that if you have Twitter user A and Twitter user B, those are both actors within the network and they're referred to as nodes. The arrow between them is the relationship between them, and that's referred to as an edge. And so the direction of the arrow is actually the direction in which the content is being shared. So we could read this first example as user A is retweeting, replying to, or mentioning user B. In something like Facebook, you wouldn't have a directed network. It would be symmetrical. You wouldn't see any arrows, right? Because we both have to be friends on Facebook. I can't just want to be your friend and you don't want to be my friend, right? That's a symmetrical relationship. So that's why it's directed. And it's also weighted. And so what that means is that if user A retweets user B 5 times, that's counted. And so that's important to note because when we're talking about the Twitter trending algorithm and we're talking about novelty of content, if you're a Twitter user and you just really love retweeting and you're retweeting the same thing over and over and over again, that's not necessarily novel even though you're sharing the content a lot, right? So we should consider weights when we're considering the network. So to run network descriptive statistics, what I did was I imported it into R and I used a package called TNet, and that predominantly deals with weighted directed networks. A lot of times people run these statistics on networks that are assumed to not be directed and assumed to be unweighted even when they are, but these statistics actually reflect the network properties of our network. And so what you could see first is the amount of nodes and edges. Unsurprisingly, Crying While White has more of these, and we just collected more tweets from Crying While White, so this kind of makes sense. But what's interesting to me here is the average path length and the average network diameter. And so what this takes into consideration for average path length is you could think of it almost like 6 degrees of separation. So in other words, how many people do you have to get through in order to get a message to any one user within the network? And this also takes into account weights, right? So even if you might be connected to all of these other people, if you have a very strong connection to one person, you're more likely to have your content go through them. And so it takes into consideration that. Now, while we can't directly compare networks of two different sizes, what one would reasonably expect is that Crying While White would have a larger average path length just because it's a larger network. However, instead we see the opposite. Alive While Black has the larger average path length, and so what that is kind of denoting is that information that's being shared within that network, it's a little bit harder to reach individuals within that network than it is for Crying While White. The average network diameter is a similar statistic. What that is looking for is just basically what's the longest path in the network that you have to take to reach anyone. And again, we could see for Alive While Black that it is a much larger path. And so there's kind of two explanations that could describe this. phenomenon. So one is the fact that you could have more authoritative hubs or users who are getting their content shared a lot in Criming While White. And so what's happening is that all individuals are kind of passing through them when they're exchanging information, and so that's why information can flow in the network so easily. Another explanation is that you could have different clusters of users interacting together, but they're connected by weak ties, right? So you have these connections that are allowing people to communicate within the network and throughout it. So I wanted to explore that further. And so what I looked at first was this idea of hubs of authority, so people who are either sharing content or having their content shared. And so what in-degree represents is it represents the amount of times you're having your content shared. So if you have an in-degree score of 5, you've had your content shared 5 times, essentially. And so what this is showing is just the distributions of Criming While White versus Alive While Black. And what's most interesting to me about these distributions is indicated by the yellow circle. So what that's showing you is that the tail for Criming While White in terms of people who are having their content shared a lot is longer than it is for Alive While Black. Now, both of these networks have pretty long tails, and as you could see, I did a transformation on the numbers, which essentially means that these networks are probably what are referred to as scale-free. And so what this means is just in a large-scale social network, you tend to have a lot of people who have their content shared once or twice, and then very few people who are having their content shared multiple times, right? So in Twitter, you could think of celebrities like, you know, Lady Gaga having her content shared a lot. So in any case, in Criming While White, though, this is more exacerbated. And so what we could think of here is that there are potentially more authoritative hubs within Criming While White in terms of having their content shared than within Alive While Black. We see the opposite for OutDegree. And so OutDegree is if you're sharing someone else's content. And so here what you can see is that the tail is longer for Alive While Black. And so what this indicates is that you have a smaller number of individuals who are sharing content frequently than in Criming While White. And so again, when we think in terms of novelty, if you have a smaller amount of people who are sharing a lot of the content, is that necessarily considered it to be novel content because you only have a few people who are doing the majority of the sharing? So then the last thing that I did was I actually mapped the networks. And for clarity, what I did was I filtered this. So I looked at people who had a total degree weight of 10 or above. And I also colored the networks so that the edges are colored by whether or not they include a URL in the content that was exchanged. You could also see that there are some nodes that are bigger than others. Those are sized by in degree, right? So the larger the circle, the more in degree weight that has. And so what you can see here is that the network is very dense, and you can also see that there's kind of no rhyme or reason to how the URLs are really being shared. There's no sort of cluster in which they're all being shared. They're kind of just distributed throughout the network. Examples from people who have the highest in-degree scores within the Alive While Black network are included here. And what you could see is that the content, at least from a surface level, looks to be similar. It's individuals who are sharing very deeply felt personal experiences of racism that they've experienced at the hands of the police or the criminal justice system. Okay, so Criming While White. You see something different here. The first thing is that there are two different clusters rather than just a dense network. And there's also some rhyme or reason to how the URLs are being exchanged. Specifically of interest to me is the fact that they're bridging the two clusters. You can also see that there are bigger circles, and so that's kind of confirming the distributions that I showed you before in the sense that you have more individuals within the Criming While White network who are having their content shared a lot. And so something that's interesting here in terms of the content of individuals who have the highest in-degree scores is the fact that the content differs depending on your position within the network. So for example, in the smaller network, this is where you have white individuals who are sharing their experiences at the hands of the police or the criminal justice. In other words, kind of things that they got away with or they were let go easy on that their black friends were not. In the middle of the network, so actually the bridging positions of the network, you have people who are trying to promote the idea of the hashtag, Criming While White, and then also trying to promote or respond to other people's tweets within the hashtag. And then finally in the bottom, you have a lot of content that's actually, again, much like I showed you in the URLs, giving you anecdotes of well-known situations in which white individuals kind of got away with something or were perceived to have gotten away with something. So with this all being said, there are a couple of key things learned from doing this sort of exploratory analysis that I linked to the Twitter trending algorithm. So the first was with novelty. So if we are thinking in terms of the network, we can see that in Criming While White, you have a lot of different topics that were being shared, and we might not, at least among the most influential users, we might not necessarily have seen that as much in the Alive While Black network, although we need to take a deeper dive into that, and so that's what Debanjan was able to do. And we also see that there were more individuals that were sharing unique content within Criming While White. For velocity, you could see that people with the Criming While White hashtag had, on average, more friends, followers, and retweets. So you just had more of a chance of exposing your tweet to other individuals. We could see that the network characteristics also facilitated movement of information throughout the sharing network of Twitter tweets. And then finally, the exchange of URLs. So something's going on here that's actually bridging the network so that there's communication. And the kind of nature of these URLs are, again, providing very popular examples of white individuals. And so this could be something in which, because they are popular examples that other people know, they potentially want to retweet hashtags. And it's been shown in past studies that when you include a URL in a tweet, you're more likely to get retweeted. So now I'm going to pass it over to Debanjan, who's going to talk more about kind of the content within the two hashtags.
Okay, so the network analysis basically showed us that we can identify the users who are tweeting, retweeting, or mentioning these two specific hashtags. And then our next objective was to understand the content. So basically, by content means that, is there any thematically or linguistic patterns are there in these two specific type of tweets that we can distinguish based on the hashtags? So we did a lot of empirical content analysis approaches, and these approaches are basically influenced by research in natural language processing. So we did here three types of analysis, basically. The first one is latent topic analysis. So it's here, it's like we take the corpus of the tweets, and we try to identify that, are there hidden topics in that specific content that were actually been implicit. The second thing is that standard sentiment analysis, and I'll come to that later. And the third is that we go much more deeper, and we try to find out some more patterns in that text by lexical choices of words, that are there any specific linguistic and psychological processes that can help us to distinguish these two contents. So first, we start with the latent topic analysis. So what we do here is basically we apply a specific generative model, which is known as LDA, and if we read our paper, or there are some other references that can guide you throughout the algorithm. But basically, what we do here is we used a specific algorithm to uncover the abstract topics in the tweets. So for instance, we take the tweets like Alive While Black or Criming While White separately, and we take only the unique tweets from there, because we don't want to mess up with that. And that actually gives us around 10 to 12,000 unique tweets for these two specific corpuses. And we apply this algorithm to identify, are there hidden topics inside this inside the content which are actually coming up. And this algorithm, in a very brief note, what it does is that it thinks that every tweet is nothing but a mixture of topics, and the topics are just a distribution of words. So how you generate a tweet, it's like you take one topic, which is a mixture of words or mixture of weight, and it takes randomly drawn words from the topics based on the distribution. So I think it's better will be, I can give you an example here. So let's see that how we are actually doing that topic analysis from the Criming While White tweets. And I can pick up one example. Say I take the third one. When I was a bartender in Ferguson, off-duty cops would joke about never pulling over white girls, okay? Now, here I'm actually showing only three topics for the brevity. And each color actually showing the different topics, and the words and the numbers are actually the probabilities of that words occurring in that topic. So you can see that there is one yellow topic which contains the words like black, Ferguson, and crime. So it's basically describing what kind of crimes happened in the recent days, and that was kind of expected that when you are studying this crime worldwide tweets. Another interesting topic is that the purple topic, which has the words like pooling, drunk, and cop. So you can think of that, okay, there will be a lot of tweets which are actually describing that we were drinking and the cops came and pulled over us and then something happened or they took some action or not actions. It will be better when we actually compare these topics side by side with the alive while black topics. And that comes in the second slide. So for instance, I pick up again the first tweet. Cop pulled my mom over as she was pulling into the driveway to ask her what she was doing in the neighborhood. So here you see that there is one another similar topic, the purple topic, which is talking about the pulling and cop. But then we actually discover that a lot of words related to neighborhood and family, these are popping up, which was kind of absent in the crime while white topic. Similarly, if you see the yellow topic, the last one, you see the word like racism and discrimination, ugly. And here what's happening actually, and maybe this picture actually gives you better, that if you see side by side these topics, so you see the yellow topics, where criming while white describe the crime, okay, like black and crime and etc. But if you see the similar topic in alive while black, it has a lot of words overlapping, but it talks about the ugly nature of discrimination and racism. And these words are actually coming up. So even if these topics are similar, there are actually a lot of difference there. Similarly, if you see the purple topic in alive while black is actually talking about neighborhoods and community. So you can think of that these topics, this tweets are not only a little more subjective, and it's actually talking about the community or where this crime actually is taking up. And we are actually kind of surprised to see that the blue topic, which was talking about the grades and school and colleges, and that came actually automatically. And then we went back and studied the tweets manually, and we found out that a lot of tweets actually talk about discrimination or how they were racially discriminated while in being in the grade school. So they're in schools and college, and the teachers are saying that, okay, you cannot study in college and et cetera reason. So there is kind of discrimination happening in the education system. And that's actually this blue topic picked up. So once we did this kind of topic analysis and thematically, we see that there are actually a lot of differences in the structure and how these topics are generated. In Criming While White, you see a lot of description about events, that the events are like drinking and cops are pulling over. But in Alive While Black, we see the events, but also these are more subjective. They're talking about their own experiences. And so we thought about that, okay, once we have the distinct topics which are actually differentiating these two type of tweets, let's do more analysis, like let's do sentiment analysis of the tweets. So, sentiment analysis is like pretty common and popular study. Like we always study positive sentiments about product reports in Amazon reviews or negative sentiments in film reviews in IMDb corpus. Here, we are specifically interested only in studying the negative sentiment. The reason is pretty clear because there is not much of positive things happening in the tweets. And the second thing was we are interested in studying the degree of negative sentiments. So is there any specific degree or subjectivity which can specifically separate these two kind of tweets? So to do this study, we used a lexicon called MPQA lexicon. It's actually created in University of Pittsburgh. And the MPQA lexicon is basically, it's a collection of words which has positive, negative, and positive negative sentiments or negations, or there are neutral words. And the words are also show that they're attributed with the subjectivity. So for instance, if you pick a word like racist, it is a negative sentiment, and also it shows that it has strong subjectivity. So We were interested in not only understanding that if this tweet expresses strong negative sentiments, we are also interested in studying something called the relative salience. And just in a like definition, the relative salience is like basically you measure the probability of a word to occur in a corpus, and then you measure the differences of the probability. So for instance, if you see a word like racist, you measure the probability of it occurring in the alive while black corpus, and similarly you compare the probability in cramming while white, and then you just measure the difference, and then you can decide that where it is most salient. And we did it for all the unique tweets that we had, and it was like mostly between 10 to 12,000 tweets. So here we just put a nice picture of the relative salience of cramming while white topics. Now the word sizes basically shows that how prominent these words are, how salient these words are. Interestingly, here you'll see the words drunk and weed. These are really, really salient with these tweets. And we went back and we saw that, okay, this is one of the biggest or the most important event that the cramming while white tweets were talking about, that the smoking and drinking, the cops came and didn't take any action, etc. So that's why you see these words like stole, and also at the same time you see the words like confession, because a lot of tweets actually confessing, so that's actually a good pick also. Now, once we move to the alive while black tweets and we measure the relative salience, here we see that more of the subjectivity or more words which are related to the expression or the experiences. You see the words like racism, which is like really giant here. And then you see the words like discrimination, heartbreaking, ugly, etc., stealing. So here, again, this words shows some kind of subjectivity or some kind of experience. That's the alive while black tweets we're talking about. And this is extremely different from the cramming while white. And we are kind of really surprised to see that even if we are using tweets, and tweets are, you know, that it's only 140 characters, and it's not like a large document. But even if you do this kind of probabilistic analysis, you figure out that what these tweets are talking, and even if they're talking about similar event, how distinct they are. So in this study, we did this kind of negative sentiment analysis by relative salience. And at the end, we thought that, okay, we can go more farther. And we can think of that, are there specific words which shows the linguistic pattern? By pattern means, we said, like, use a pronouns, or is there words related to psychological processing or any social events, and et cetera. And to do this, we utilized a specific dictionary called LIWC, L-I-W-C, which is, the broad form is Linguistic Inquiry and Word Count. So LIWC is a dictionary. It has words for categories. So it has a, it has 64 categories, the dictionary, and each category actually represent a different type of psychological or social processes. So for instance, you have a category which express only the words related to pronouns, like second pronoun, or you have words related to emotions and concern about work and death and other psychological thing. Now, what we did here is like we pick every tweet and then we try to compute that the frequency of occurrence of a LIWC category in that specific tweet. So that specific tweet will be like which encapsulate a specific type of category in LIWC. So we took that two corpuses separately again, and we counted the number of occurrences for each category here. And then we basically, in this study, we did a calculated the mean rank differences between the cramming while white and alive while black tweets. And this table actually, this graph actually shows you that what are the most important or most striking significant categories that has come up in the cramming while white. So for instance, the first one is ingestion, and that's kind of given because a lot of tweets actually talking about drinking and smoking and et cetera. And then it talk about death, and in person is like it talking about it and they. So it's basically not talking about pronouns as in like I or you or et cetera, but it's talking about a third person, and then negations and other topics. Similarly, if we go to the alive wild black corpus and we do a similar analysis, we see the topics like related to family. It's actually becoming a very strong category here. And as I said before, that there is a lot of tweets which talk about the community and family member and sister and mother, etc. So that was kind of expected. And there is other category like social process, which talking about that how we are meeting everyone or talking and etc. So this graph actually shows you separately that if you study every single category in a Lyric dictionary, these are kind of the results that you see the mean difference between these two topics. But at the end that we thought that how about we combine every topic in a single dimension so that every dimension of this category can interact with each other. And then we'll try to find out that which is the most significant category that can discriminate these two types of tweets. So for that, we did a simple binary logistic regression experiment. So what we're doing here is like, in a nutshell, that you pick one tweet, you pick up the words and think that which category of Lyric they actually belong. And then we try to predict that if is it the alive while black tweet or is it a crying while white tweet. And based on the categories, we can think of that which are more significant categories from the perspective of these two types of hashtags. So here, for crying while white, you see that use of past tense and negation is a very strong feature. And use of past tense because you know that most of the tweets are actually describing that what they did before, what kind of crime they have done before, and now they're reporting. So use of past tense is a strong category. Mention of injections and causation, because a lot of tweets are actually explaining like because I did this and I was wearing a military dog tag and so the I didn't get a DUI and etc. So that's why this causation category is very prominent here. Similarly, if you see the alive while black, use of second pronoun, it's very strong because these tweets contain a lot of quotations and so that like the cops are coming and they're asking that why you are in this neighborhood and why you're driving fast and etc. As expected, mention of sadness and anxiety, this is also a very strong category in Alive While Black, and it's talking about their own personal experiences. And mention of community, home, family, members, and neighborhoods, and etc., are also a very strong category for Alive While Black. So in summary, what you find out that crying while white tweets detail actions surrounding crime and police actions, but they're mostly individualistic. So they don't talk about anything subjective. They just represent what happened before. And it's just like they do this thing as like an event expression. But at the same time, if you see that alive while black, they are talking about specific experience of discrimination. And they also describe orientation towards their community. And a lot of words related to family members and neighborhood and et cetera are very strong here. So for future work here, for more content analysis type of problem, we are thinking to do, how about that we do a joint modeling of content and network at the same time. So we take the tweets which are passing through the network as Venice has shown, and can we do the analysis of content using that network information together? So that's one thing we are really interested. The other thing we are interested is that a lot of tweets actually uses other hashtags. So in according, like you have alive while black, but it will use like hashtag Eric Garner and other hashtags. So we can use those secondary hashtags to discover more tweets and can add up to our corpuses. That's from the content analysis part. And
yeah, and so then I think from the network analysis portion, what's very interesting to me is the co-location of hashtags. And so I had mapped networks looking, including use of both hashtags, and something that I found that was pretty interesting to me was the fact that in Alive While Black, you had this one ebony digital editor who had started the hashtags. And then immediately after, if you look at this in terms of time when the tweets were actually posted, you didn't have a lot of interaction yet until you had this Mashable blogger actually use both hashtags. So he used Alive While Black with Criming While White in order to alert people who were using the Criming While White hashtag to the existence of this other hashtag. And then after he did this, you had a lot of people who were using both hashtags in order to kind of raise awareness. So that was something that was interesting to me. And so how can kind of using a hashtag that might not be used as much with a more popular hashtag, how can that kind of raise awareness, and how does that work within a network? Something else that's interesting to me is looking, we didn't look at the user descriptions, but I would be very interested in seeing the differences in user descriptions and also their positions within the network, as well as the type of content that they're sharing in terms of how these hashtags were disseminated. So yeah, now we'd love to open it up to questions, comments. We all come from different backgrounds here, so I'd love to hear kind of different perspectives of this.
My leg just fell asleep, so.
It's not quite a question for you, it's more of a reflection. I like the idea of you going to this question of how to combine content and network to get at a set of analytic inquiries. And in particular, part of what I can't help but think about your case study is that you're not only looking at content that reflects the battles of racism within the United States predominantly, I realize this is international as well, but you're also showing structurally the way in which racism can be made visible through the structures of the content and the networks you're looking at holistically. When we think about how we deal with prejudice in this country, at least, and racism in particular, we talk about it within legal frames. We talk about it in terms of discrimination against protected classes as measured by intentional discrimination or as measured by disparate impact. These metrics actually don't reveal the soft, squishy reality of the racist culture that helps produce those outcomes. What I can't help but wonder is, as you start to look at these networks and the content, if you can't come up with a different way or a different frame for thinking about how to measure racism that pushes against just the legal frame of it and pushes more to one that is sociological and in many ways structural through the material that you see, you know, borne out. And again, I don't know that you have the answer to that. It's more a matter of like something I'd encourage you to think about as you're marrying these things, because I think that that can be a place where it goes beyond just the content of the particular artifact you're looking at, but more holistically as you start to see all of this bubbling up through social media.
So one of the things that was really interesting for me when I was reading the paper and also during your presentation was was this difference between kind of breadth and depth and the strength of the nodes, and what that might mean for how these hashtags were moving through mainstream media. So can you talk a little bit more about those kind of large nodes that you saw with Criming While White, and whether or not that was just something that resulted because, I don't know, whether or not it was like an easier topic for mainstream media to approach, if that's kind of something you saw or anything.
Right, yeah, so that's actually interesting, right? And that's why I say that this is exploratory, because I'm not in any sort of way trying to show causality and to say this, you know, is why or that is why. Again, Criming While White could have been expressed more and, you know, trended more just because it started earlier. We really don't know. However, that being said, you know, my suspicion would be that the media could have picked up Criming While White a little bit more than they did Alive While Black, because in Criming While White, the content, as Debanjan was kind of showing you, they're kind of more reporting on their experiences. And so they're kind of presenting content in what we would consider an objective frame, right? And so you're also showing these more mainstream examples that a lot of people can grab onto and kind of recognize. So I think that that could be something that's, it's easier to show a tweet where you're showing a picture of Wall Street and saying, you know, these people weren't punished, why not? As opposed to just showing one individual's experience that they're just reporting on. So I would think that that's maybe just the perceived impact could be, you know, one reason, but you know, I'm not 100%. That would be one of my guesses.
Another kind of interesting thing that I thought about the work was how the tweets were kind of distributing between networks. So with AliveWell Black, did you see this in terms of people sharing, were these much smaller communities where they were sharing it between each other? And what kind of relationship did you see between kind of person-to-person, more symmetrical relationships versus these asymmetrical relationships?
Yeah, so it's interesting because with weighted directed networks, there's only specific measures that you can do because other measures that you do just don't apply to those networks. That being said, you can calculate something, it's called a clustering coefficient, and essentially what that's saying is how many people are connected within the network into these smaller groups. And so the clustering coefficients, when you compare them, they're slightly larger for AliveWell Black, which would give you kind of the idea that you do have, as you said, these smaller groups who are kind of communicating amongst themselves, but not necessarily across one another. However, for both groups, and I think this is kind of endemic to social networks, is that these kind of clustering coefficients, at least at a global level, tend to be pretty small. Just because you tend to have these more popular individuals who you are talking through that are connecting. There's another measure called the local clustering coefficient, which would more get at the density of these little groups. But for weighted networks, the measures remain kind of contested. So I didn't want to necessarily calculate them, but that would be an interesting kind of thing just to explore and see if you see more clustering between how people are communicating. What we did notice, though, and why I kind of wanted to include in my structural portion replies and mentions as well as retweets when we're talking about sharing, is that in AliveWell Black, people used mentions not more than in Crying While White, but they use them more at specific individuals within the network. So in other words, the Ebony.com senior digital editor who started the tweet, a lot of people either mentioned her or replied to her with their stories. And it's interesting because the comedian who started the Crying While White hashtag, people didn't necessarily reply to him or mention him as much. Instead, they just took the hashtag and started sharing their own stories. So again, we could think of this in terms of people within AliveWell Black, they're having a conversation and they're sharing their experiences in that sort of way. Whereas in Crying While White, again, it's just kind of more within this reporting frame of you're just either reporting or you're sharing what other people have reported, that type of thing.
I'm really curious. I guess my question is methodological and sort of if you can contextualize your findings in terms of other related work. I'm coming from an entirely qualitative, ethnographic, very different way of looking at manipulating evidence and information. So I'm just curious about whether it's in the context of structural violence or institutionalized racism, or whether it's just about content analysis, network analysis generally, like how does this compare to both your specific method and your findings, if that makes sense?
You can take first. You can take off.
It's a huge question.
Yeah, no, so it's a good one. So the first kind of caveat I want to say is that I particularly, because I apply mixed methods, and so I'm very concerned when I'm applying quantitative methods into the way that I'm presenting my data, because often, you know, you can kind of massage the numbers a little bit to go for the argument that you want to make. And so I try to be very conscious of that when you're making those arguments. And then also the fact that we can't necessarily say, oh, you know, our quant work objectively is showing us this, just because we have all of these additional data points that are collected. That being said, kind of, is your question more like how common is this sort of analysis in social network analysis? So from what I can see, especially in terms of social network analysis, it's done a lot in terms of how quickly content is shared when for activism and mobilization within Twitter. And so, in other words, you know, when you're kind of, I even think for this network originally, I wanted to collect tweets under the hashtag shut it down, because I was very interested in seeing how people were mobilizing in order to march after this verdict came in. But I haven't seen it done in terms of just comparing two direct networks in order to say, you know, which network is kind of information flowing through more easily versus another network in which it's not. Again, you can't, my other caveat with this is you can never directly compare networks. The only thing that you could do is generate a random picture of a network with the same amount of nodes and edges as the one that you have to say, oh, is this measure abnormal or is this measure abnormal? So comparing the two, we have to be careful. Again, we can kind of look at them side by side and see what we see, but we can't necessarily compare. And I also think that this is kind of a rare context, because you don't necessarily have these dual hashtags crop up around the same time that are communicating two different perspectives on the same subject, which is interesting.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Sorry.
The first time, like when you started this experiment, initially we were only interested to do the topic analysis, because we thought that we are not clear about that what kind of results or information we'll get, because once we retrieved the tweets, these were, as Vanessa said, it was like 50,000 or 60,000 tweets, and manually to go through each tweet, it's not that possible or feasible. So we thought that first we'll do analysis of the topics, and let's see that is there any specific similarity or dissimilarities. And I would say that I was not expecting this kind of difference between the tweets, because as I said also, that tweets are shorter documents, like it's only 140 characters. And this kind of modeling works better where you have like a larger document, like news and articles and books and et cetera. But still, we got something from there, and that's why I was saying that if we get more data and we add into the corpus, that actually massages the probabilities much better in the words, because you see that once you have a bigger corpus, it's kind of expressing or reflecting what's happening in the real world. So once we get that results from the topics, then at the second stage, we thought that, okay, now we have seen that there are some specific differences between the topics. We can go through word by word and just do lexical analysis and see that if there is differences in expressions of sentiments and emotions and other linguistic patterns. And yeah, as I said, it was very exploratory. And to answer your other question, it's kind of not that uncommon to use this kind of empirical content analysis for tweets. There is a lot of work happening related to tweets, and as you know that extracting a million tweets, it's not that difficult for any specific hashtags or topics. And there's a lot of fascinating work, like for instance, identifying sarcasm in tweets using a pure empirical analysis. It's all there. So,
And then I would say one interesting thing for future work that we hadn't mentioned, that we kind of combine methods, is actually taking something like topic modeling, but then going in and using that to build a qualitative coding scheme, mm-hmm. and then coding, so that you're kind of getting that more rich picture of the data, as opposed to just taking a bird's eye view of what's going on. So you could kind of explain that better. And to your point, I think that that would be a nice approach to kind of get at more of these subtleties, as opposed to just saying, this is, you know, in terms of legal system, right, what you're doing.
Right, and to add to her point, One thing, it's actually a very good point that once we have the topics, these are actually generated automatically and they don't have any label. So it will be really great that if you have annotators who see the words and try to give up some name to the topics, and that actually helps in all downstream applications, that now you have names or labels, you actually can see that what kind of topics are emerging from the document. And it's pretty similar in the thing of, like, if you think qualitative annotating documents.
So one of the things about Twitter's trending topics is that, like any algorithm that can be manipulated, it's constantly dancing with the manipulations. You referenced Justin Bieber, and part of it is that when it was originally designed, the designers assumed that frequency would be good enough. And the original incarnation of trending topics was just what is most frequently being discussed. And of course, Bieber, 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 Bieber. It kept going. And in fact, when all of the trending topics were Bieber for, I think it was 3 months in a row, the entire time, that was when they finally decided that they need to deal with this. And this is where you get to see this very mixed method dynamic. Now, what's tricky about trending topics is that, of course, it brings visibility to things that were not previously visible, which is creates these feedback loops and is indeed part of the dynamic that you have to contend with, is the fact that when they are visible, we get more tweets. When they are visible, people respond to it. All of these different elements. But of course, they're also being gamed. And that's where we see the algorithm underpinning trending topics having changed dramatically and continuously changing. And I'm curious, based on the stuff that you've seen and the political implications of a lot of what you're looking at, what would you argue should be some of the things that trending topics should be taking into consideration that they are currently not? Because right now what they're taking into consideration, velocity is one of it, structural difference. So, for example, if people tweet about the same topic and they are not, and they have the largest distance possible, the further that distance is, the more likely that they will be trending topics. Indeed, this is one of the things that gets gamed. Kony 2012 is a perfect gaming of that. So, like, what are some of the other properties that you think should be taken into consideration, and how would they change, in many ways, the value system of the trending topics mechanism?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. So Sanjay Sharma actually wrote a really interesting paper that also kind of served to inspire this work. And I think it's called something like Black Twitter and Social Contagion. And so essentially what that paper is exploring is the materiality and kind of these technocultural assemblages of tweets from Black Twitter. And so, you know, his kind of idea was it's positive in a way for individuals who are using Black tags for gaming the system because they're actually getting their hashtags to trend. However, there's different ways in which hashtags, as you mentioned, kind of can trend, and kind of there's different ways in which their trends are sustainable over time. And so he cites a paper, and I want to say one of the authors is Romero. I don't remember the other one, but essentially what they did was they looked at different trending topics and they were able to create a typology of 7 different ways in which a topic can trend. And so, for example, for hashtags like this, or for often Black tags, or any other hashtags that tend to be just like a quick pop cultural moment, they're kind of in and out like a flash. And so I don't necessarily know how you would do this, but I would think really looking at these more ephemeral hashtags and kind of trying to distinguish other characteristics that might differentiate them would be something that would be interesting, because then you also have political hashtags that have different kind of patterns of contagion and sharing over time, and they trend for different amounts of times. But I would think looking at these very ephemeral hashtags, because it sounds to me, based on the research that's been done mapping these out, that they are the ones that have the most diverse kind of types of content that are being discussed. So something that would look more into those types of content.
Hi, thanks for your presentation. I came to learn more about network mapping because I didn't know much about it. I'm not a tech person. But I come from a community-based participatory research background, and so I'm curious about some of the principles of informed consent and kind of moving beyond a do no harm principle in research, and how, if at all, that is applied to network mapping, kind of the ethical implications of studying and taking this information, how and whether this can be used to amplify social movements, if informed consent even needs to apply in this context, if you could talk a bit about that.
I told them that they were going to ask you this question.
Okay, yeah, so that's actually been something that I've been wrestling with, because I've also done larger scale research looking at social question answering networks, particularly within the LGBT or queer communities. And so, you know, with that kind of information, you're talking about I don't think that necessarily even just saying, okay, we're going to preserve anonymity is enough. Now, for a community like that, what the best practices are among, at least I know the researchers who do things like that, so online message board work and things like that, are to get involved and then also to tell the community, hey, I have this paper that I did, you know, on your community. I'm going to share it with you. Can you please read it? And you can also do member checks that way before you actually go and publish the paper, and then also kind of try to see to make sure that you don't have as much negative backlash. Now, of course, because these sites, their terms of service, they're public, sometimes people won't go for IRB or things like that. I generally always go for an exemption just because I like to have something there. But in terms of informed consent on something like Twitter, where we're dealing with a lot more people, I'm not necessarily sure how you could do it. I mean, I guess you could tweet at the hashtag, right, and kind of say who you are and what you're researching and see what comes back. But I mean, I know that not everyone's going to, I'm not very visible on Twitter. I only use it to scrape data, so I just have an egg, you know? So I'm not sure how many people are going to necessarily be responding to me. But I also think being a member of the community is sometimes helpful with those sorts of things too, because then you have more traction to do things like that. What we did, especially for presenting the data, was we only presented names in which the people were kind of more well-known, and we left everything else to be anonymous. But yeah, and I mean, if anyone else has ideas of how to do more ethical research, especially at such a large scale, I mean, I would love to hear that.
So from the like quantitative perspective of Twitter actually doesn't allow you to share the data. So for instance, we have 100,000s or maybe more than tweets related to these two specific hashtags, but I cannot give you the tweets. I actually only can share the IDs of the tweets, and you have to go back using the Twitter APIs to download the tweets using those IDs. So that's how somehow Twitter actually kind of blocks that direct communication of the data. Exactly, because if you go back to tweets, you know, like maybe 30% of the data, which was last year, it's already been lost. So that's one problem of the reproducibility in Twitter.
Hi, so I have not necessarily a question, but kind of a thought about the idea and the way that this is being framed. That might kind of clarify some of the shock or the differences between the two hashtags and all of the analysis that you have been doing. So while I'm thinking that while these two things are being compared as being the same, they might not necessarily be the same thing. And what you're saying, like dual hashtags on the same topic, I'm not seeing them as exactly the same topic. The similarity that I'm seeing is an interaction with the criminal justice system, and one being the ways that people have gotten off while committing crimes, and the other being non-wanted interactions with a system for simply being alive. And so by putting those two things together, I think you're going to get different results, simply because one is emotionally grounded and in the idea of prejudice, in the idea of bias, in the idea of racism, because you're simply being alive and this thing is coming to you. And another is, you know, getting away because you did something that was illegal. So I think by comparing those things, that they're not necessarily the same, you're getting different results, essentially.
What's going on? Okay. So content-wise, I mean, you're absolutely correct. So there are some discrimination, there are some differences in the approaches. But one interesting thing is that all the different type of empirical analysis we did, we are basically interested in understanding the differences. So there are a lot of tweets, actually, which are having a lot of overlap. Even if you see manually these tweets, the Kramming while white or Alive while black, it's not always they are very different. There are a lot of overlaps between those tweets. But all the time, we are actually trying to pick up the differences between the probabilities and other measures. We actually captured the words or linguistic pattern, which are actually at the end of the two systems. So that's one thing. But of course, there are a lot of overlaps between the text, so it's not always they're very different. But the measure that we use, we are not actually looking into the common aspects, but we are more interested into the dissimilar things.
Yeah, and I think you bring up a good point. And that was something where, you know, I think that that original kind of question that I had was very simplistic. You know, it was just something that said, oh, you know, these tweets are being juxtaposed together, and let's see if they're actually different. And the reason why kind of the question was framed in that way for me was just to say that a lot of times I know that research on race in Twitter tends to be very identitarian and essentialist, and we tend to say, okay, this is the experience that everyone is having who is using this hashtag or whatnot. And so my interest there as well was just trying to see kind of, can we pick out some of the more subtle nuances in terms of what's occurring within those tweets, and not necessarily saying, okay, these aren't different and we're not expecting to find differences, but also to say, how are people expressing this differently, and how might the ways in which the differences be working privilege one group over another?
So this year, David Troy did a really interesting analysis of at Personal Democracy Forum of who's following who within different cities and seeing what are the different communities within within urban environments. When you go back, can you go back to the slide that you had of linking I don't know what that is. Yeah, the network degree. Can you go to the bigger blob?
Like this one?
That one. Yeah. What type of communities were you finding, like specific communities within there? Were you finding certain geographic references that were connected to each other? Can you kind of describe the meta inside of this big old blob more detailed?
So that's actually a great and unanswered question. That's something that we're trying to pursue now, because in terms of, I'm interested in terms of location, and then also in terms of user descriptions. And particularly from a political standpoint, what are people's kind of political leanings that are causing them to tweet, and what clusters are they tweeting in? Now, I don't know how many of the tweets they picked up, but I know that Quartz actually did an analysis on Alive While Black as a network, and they actually looked at exactly what you're saying, the geography and then also descriptions of individuals. And what they were finding when they were comparing it to Ferguson-related hashtags is that in Ferguson-related hashtags, they tended to see with their data and their analysis that there was kind of this division between people who were kind of more conservative and living in kind of the middle of America or the South, who were talking about the protests in a specific way, and then you had people who were kind of on the sides who were talking about it in a different way and identified more as liberal, and they weren't communicating the two groups. Now, with the Alive While Black hashtag, what they found there was that you actually had individuals of different political leanings, but they were all communicating to one another And so their kind of initial comments about this was that, you know, this is very encouraging because we're actually having this dialogue and it seems to be a little bit more holistic within this hashtag. But then they did more data analysis on it and they found that one of the reasons why they might have had that initial finding is because after the hashtag started trending, you had all of the people who identified as being kind of conservative and coming from red states dropping off completely from the conversation. And so in other words, the conversation was kind of dominated more by these individuals who identified as liberal and were living in other areas of the country. But as far as our own research, we have not done that yet. What I was looking to do is actually use Python to parse locations from what people list, and then also do some analysis on the descriptions and then map them to the network so we could also look at that problem. But that's a great, you know, kind of future thing for us to do.
So we're out of time. I wanted to thank Vanessa and Debanjan again. Thank you.